Okay, picture this. You've just gotten an incredible design to your hands. The architecture is perfect. The details are flawless. And now, you want to add some motion. You want to project to come to life. But wait, how do you actually animate the architectural project? Today, we're diving deep into the world of art with animations, the perfect way to showcase designs in motion. Alright, let's get started. I like to think about animations as a still image with added movement. Let me explain. To produce animations, you have to create the scene similarly like you create it for visualizations. All the steps that need to be included have to be in animation too. We have to set up the composition and camera. We need to choose the lighting scenario for that view, use the power of colors to convey a specific message, add high-quality materials, add assets and story to the image, and also, don't forget about post-production. And then, you add movement on top of that. The basic motion will be a camera movement, however, we can create static shots too. To make the animation more realistic, we can add movement to various objects, for example, plants, people, water. The possibilities are endless. However, many times, even one or two moving objects are enough, especially when the cuts are quick. It's all about the impression. Now let's talk about technical stuff. Still image is simply one frame, while animations are made from multiple frames. When creating animation, you have to choose how many frames will be shown per second. And this is called frame rate. The normal frame rate used in most films or videos is 24, 25 or 30 frames per second. For example, if the frame rate is 30, it means that each second of the video has 30 frames, so 30 single images. In D5, we can choose between 30 and 60 frames per second. We can use 60 when we want to create a slow motion effect. Animations are more complex than visualizations simply because there is more shots, moving objects, cameras, and so on. You have to think about the rendering times and all the potential issues that can come along the way. However, in D5, all is super easy, no issues like that. The process is very intuitive and there is no need to set so many settings before rendering to eliminate noise or flickers. When creating animations, the timeline is where the motion is created. In D5, we have three core elements: clips, shots, and views. Each clip can contain multiple shots, and shots are made of views. We can have multiple clips, and we can click here to add a new one. It can be handy if we, for example, want to have exterior and interior shots separately. It makes life way easier and the file way more organized. To add a shot, we first have to create a view, which will be the first frame of our shot. So basically, we have to find our starting point, the view of how our shot will be start. When you're ready, just click here. Similarly, like in the still images, we have to think about composition, type of shots, etc. Move the view, adjust the frame, and click add view. Here, I want a simple forward movement, called dolly shot. Here we go, we've just created the first shot of our animation. It's too fast. This kind of shot should be slower. To make the shot slower, we can simply add more time here. The longer the shot, the slower the movement. Now, we have a shot that is twice as slow. Not so complicated so far, isn't it? Let's try to create one more shot. This time, a more close-up camera. I like the tree to frame my view. It will add a more intimate feel to it. Great, and let's create the pan movement to the right. In general, in commercial artist projects, camera movements are rather slow and chilled. But we can add dynamics through the cuts. This means that we can have more short shots than one long one. For that reason, when we set the camera, we shouldn't do too prominent movement as it will be too quick. We can also set the depth of field. And what's more, we can animate it too. So firstly, we'll have a focus on the tree. And then, along with the movement, we change the focus to the house. It's a nice technique that not only adds dynamics and interest to the image, but this way, we also can guide the viewer to focus on specific things. You just have to remember to update the view every time you do the change. We can also add the views between the first and the last. For example, we want to have the focus on the tree longer. You can see that we have focus until here, it is changing. You can notice that shot is super slow. It's because from the first to the middle view, we have 6 seconds length. From the middle to the last, we have 3 seconds. That's not a problem, as we can easily change it here. What is great here, we see exactly how the final output will look like. No need for test views or simple previews, we can actually render the whole animation straight away as everything is set up. Now, The shorter the distance between the start and finish view, the slower it will be. So to make our processes easier, we can actually choose the views in between those views and update the final one. I like to do it this way. Also, we can change the times between the shots as well as the total time of the shot. We can also duplicate the shot. We can also edit the path, whatever we like to move the whole path or adjust the points. What I like is that we can see the preview of the changes. Otherwise, it will be super hard to adjust. We can delete any view at any time by clicking the minus icon. When we click, we can see a bunch of different options. We can move the shots just by moving them in a specific direction. Finally, we can delete the shot if we wish. As we know all the basics, now let's try to answer the question. What we can do to make our animation interesting? How to actually create an animation that catches attention and makes viewer feel? As we said before, what differentiates animation from visualization is the motion. Let's start with the camera movements. We can have simple motions like straight backward or forward movement, the camera going up or down. But we can also use some more crazy ones if it matches the idea. What is great about D5, you don't have to create those movements from scratch. You can choose from the template. All you have to do is select the movement you need, and the shot will be automatically created based on your current view. In the settings, you can change the direction of the movement. We can, for instance, change it to move to the left. To affect the speed, we have to adjust the distance between the starting and end points of the camera. The shorter the distance, the slower the camera. You can see it's super easy and can save lots of time, especially with more complicated shots. I recommend checking them all out to see what you can achieve. We can of course also change the length of the shot as always. There are more settings depending on the movement you choose, but for instance, the projection mode or clipping is constant. We can use the clipping option when we want to get rid of certain objects in front of our camera as they block the view. You should also know the out of view interval option. After enabling this option, if you change a certain time in the shot, the time interval of each view in the shot will be recalculated automatically, so that the speed is always the same between different views. Talking about the camera movements, we also have to talk about the movement's curves and how the motion looks along the shot. We can have linear move, which is constant all the way. Ease in will make the camera speed up at the end. Ease out will do the opposite, so you will have the camera slower at the end. Ease in out will slow down at first, then speed up and slow down again. Speed in out will do the opposite, so it will speed up at first, then slow down and speed up again. I like to choose linear in most cases. We can do the same for rotation if we have any. Except for the camera movement, we can also animate objects, including lights. All these details make a huge difference in the perception of the space, making it more realistic. It's a great way to add life and dynamics to your video. If you want to convey a story, characters are the most powerful assets. They automatically drag our attention, and viewers can identify themselves with them very easily. We can animate objects manually, simply with the use of the keyframes. We have to select the frame we want to start the animation. For me, it will be the first frame, and click here. We can also adjust the keyframe manually by moving it along the timeline. Then move to the end frame, adjust the position of the object, and as we're ready, add the new key. Here we go. The idea is similar to the camera animation. We basically set the start and end positions. If you would like to make the animation more complex, we could add the keyframes in between. We can adjust it at any point, move or delete the key. For this object, we can adjust some animation's parameters like speed, for instance, simply by moving the slider. If we want to create crowd simulation though, we can use path tool. The process will be similar for vehicles and animals. We can choose whatever models we like and create a path. I personally don't like to add too many people to animations, as they stand out from reality the most. However, in the larger spaces or exterior shots, there are many times necessary to show the full context, scale, and purpose of this space. We can adjust it to the view at any time. We can also animate lights. We can, for instance, turn them on and off. The process is similar to before, but here we animate the light switch parameter. So add the key and turn the lights off. Then move to the frame you want the lights to be turned on. Add the key and turn on the lights. You can see the light is turned on when it reaches the selected keyframe. We can animate the movement, rotation, and scale in the same way. Another example is the timelapse. It is a photographic technique of taking a sequence of frames to record changes that take place slowly over time. In the 3D software, to create the effect, we animate the sun. Select the time of the day you want the animation to start and set the view. Then set the final time and add the end view. Here we go! Our timelapse is ready. We can adjust the movement of the sun and sky too. You can see that, as you know the basics, all have the same rule. Again, we can build on that. We can add the camera movement now. Another example of adding story to your image may be things like fire in the fireplace or steam above the coffee cup. It makes the shot more cozy and intimate. To add it, the process is a bit different. Firstly, we have to add a plane from the asset library. Next, in the material template, choose multimedia. Choose the file with a black background. Here we go. We can remove the background with the transparency set to 1. If needed, we can adjust other parameters to get the desired effect, but that's basically it. Finally, adding the right assets is what adds a story to the animation. What is great in D5 is that we get a library of 3D assets. We have everything we need. If you see this icon next to the image, then it means that it is animated. You can see there are plenty of objects with the motion. In the interior shots, for instance, I like to add some animated assets like curtains. You don't have to add many animated objects, just the curtain will be enough for most interior shots. In the library, we can also find particles. For example, we have an animated fog that we can use above the bath in the bathroom shot, or the water coming from the tap, or we have the ready-to-use animated fire. You can see, it's everything here. Remember, all of those things we've just talked about add the story to your video. The lighting, the types of shots, the movement, and the assets. In animation, you have to be careful though, as all of the shots have to create one whole story. So remember, start with the idea and then build on that. Adjust the lighting and effects of the shots to match the overall idea. As you're ready, send your animation to render. Choose the resolution, format is MP4, and set the frame rate. You can either render the specific shot or send the whole clip. For this example, it took 2 minutes to render a 4K shot. Incredible! It's obviously way faster than offline rendering. For comparison, even if each frame will take 2 minutes to render, which will be super fast, it will take 8 hours to render this shot with offline rendering. Both solutions have their pros and cons, however, in terms of the rendering speed, there is no comparison. Anyway, I hope you liked the video and see you soon in the next one. If you'd like to test out D5 for free, check out the link in the description. Let me know in the comments what you think about creating animations in real-time engines like D5. Bye-bye!